All right, let's now learn how we can translate familiar concepts such as dropout and batch norm to the convolutional setting. So these are also called spatial dropout and batch norm. And it sounds fancier than it really is because you will see it's pretty straightforward and there's not much work required to make these things work for the two-dimensional setting, where with 2D I mean two-dimensional images. So before we talked about dropout in the multilayer perceptron context, so why do we even have to invent a new version of dropout now? Why do we have to modify it in the first place? So that is because, I mean, you can of course use the regular dropout you learned about before, but there's a good argument by Thompson here in this paper I linked below that the problem with regular dropout is that in CNNs you usually have images where you slide your kernels over the image, and usually the adjacent pixels are likely highly correlated to each other. So if you remove half of the pixels in a given receptive field, it doesn't really change the output too much, except it's maybe like a little bit of a scaling difference. You can also think of it, for instance, if you have an input, I mean, we are not masking anything in the input, but just conceptually, let's think about it like that. You have a face image, and here there are lots of pixels corresponding to the eye. If you consider one pixel here, there are other pixels closely next to it, and all these pixels together represent an eye. So it doesn't really change that much if we mask half of these pixels. So here the argument is to, instead of masking or dropping out individual positions in a feature map, we are dropping out the channels. So usually in the later stages of the network, these channels represent higher or larger concepts, as we've talked about in the last lecture, where we have bigger picture concepts like a channel represents the eye that was detected, one the mouth, one the nose, and so forth. So here the idea is really to drop these higher order features, in that way dropping entire feature maps instead of individual pixels. So essentially dropout 2D is dropout applied to the channels rather than the pixels. So you would drop an entire channels instead of pixels. And that's all there is to it. So how do we do that in PyTorch? It's pretty straightforward. So instead of saying dropout 1D, you are now saying dropout 2D. And that's essentially it. So here's an example showing you how that looks like. So each box here represents one channel. So here I have just some random example input with three channels. And you can see two of these channels are now zeroed out. That's how spatial dropout works, and that's all there is to it. It's not very complicated. The same with batch norms. Instead of using batch norm 1D, which we used earlier when we talked about multi-layer perceptrons or fully connected layers, for the convolutional layers we use batch norm 2D. So it's shown here. So just to briefly recap, I don't want to explain batch norm again because we have a video for that. But in the regular batch norm, in the 1D version, we were computing things for each feature. So we were computing this gamma and beta for each feature over the batch dimension. So if n is my batch size here, we have an input that is two-dimensional. It is n times m, where let's say m is the number of features. So this is my input dimension. So we had usually, let's say, a table where we have different features. Let's call them f1, f2, and f3. So we have three features here. And here, this is our batch dimension. So we were computing for each feature a gamma and a beta. So they were all different gammas and betas. Let's use yellow. So we had, if we had three features, we had three gammas and three betas. Now we extend this concept here to the two-dimensional case, where we compute these four inputs that are four-dimensional, right? Because we have now the batch size, we have the channels, we have the height, and we have the width. So we compute the batch norm now over the number of inputs, height and width. So in that sense, we combine these. So we average essentially over these, and we have then the same. So the number of gammas and beta is the one corresponding to the number of channels. So if we have 64 channels, we have 64 gammas and 64 betas in that sense. So we are computing it over the number of batches, height and width here. So yeah, here is essentially a summary of what I just said, just for your records if you want to look at it again. And here's how we can do that in PyTorch. So if this is my convolutional layer here, I just define the number of input channels and the number of output channels, and then I apply batch norm to that. Here the number of parameters, the number of betas and gammas of batch norm, is the number of output channels, so we have to put a 192 here, because I have 192 output channels. So we'll have 192 betas and 192 gammas. All right, that is it. In the next video, I will briefly recap that there are different architectures around there, and then we will talk about VGG16 and ResNet.